found everywhere you can listen to podcasts. It's Caffeinated and Confused with Hannah.
That's a very confusing time for any young lady.
And just like that, your girl's back. So here's the deal. I know that it's been a couple of months since I have released an episode of Caffeinated and Confused, and I kind of did it without even like explaining. So let me explain now. If you follow me on social media or you know anything about me or you just know how busy summer is, then you've probably seen that I've had literally no time to do anything with the podcast the last couple of months. And I didn't want to just half-ass it. I didn't want to just come on here and be like stressed out and then be like, oh, I have to do a podcast. So I decided to take the summer off from podcasting. And I was like, you know what? I'll come back in the fall. And I've been thinking about it the last couple of weeks. I'm like, all right, I got to start reaching out to people. I need to, you know, start coming up with some ideas of some fun episodes that I know that you would enjoy. And then I found out that Meghan Patrick was going to be coming to town for her radio tour. She's got a brand new album coming out on Friday. And I was like, that's actually the perfect opportunity to bring the podcast back because I've never met Meghan Patrick. I love her music. And so I was like, that will be really fun to have, you know, a girly pop chat to kind of start the new era of Caffeinated and Confused. Or I should probably say like season two. I feel like podcasts do that, right? They have different seasons. So we will consider this season two. So I do have my chat with Meghan Patrick coming up here in a bit. And I have to say that I did not expect to like love her as much as I knew I would like her a lot, but man, she is very real. She's very open. She's very honest. Like we had some deep life talks. We really got into it and I just loved everything about it. So I hope you stick around for that conversation and I hope you buy, listen, stream, whatever, her brand new album on Friday, because as you'll be able to hear in our talk, she put like everything into this album. So I'm super, super excited for her. So that is coming up, but I guess, you know, we usually do a pit and peak. If you're new to the podcast, we do a pit and peak every episode. I try to have a guest on every week where we just kind of go over the high and the low of the last week. But obviously, I haven't done a podcast in, you know, quite some time. So I figured I should do a pit and peak of the summer. And if I'm being completely transparent with you, I did not prepare anything at all. Ahead of this, I was like, I probably should have thought what my pit and peak was, but that wouldn't be me. That wouldn't be me being caffeinated and confused as I'm literally drinking my coffee right now. So let's talk about my pit. I'm trying to think of what I really didn't have any pit moments this summer, which is good. I guess my pit, and I feel like any working social human being will understand this, just how busy it was, which is good. And I guess I put half of it on myself because I can't say no to things. But I didn't really have a lot of just chill time this summer, whether it was, you know, going and doing stuff for social life or working. Like I worked a lot of weekends, but, you know, all good stuff. I guess that is the pit that you want to have, is that you just have too much stuff to do. So I will say that that was my pit. My peak of the summer, man, there's been so many peaks, so many peaks. I'm just, man, how do I even start? I guess the first thing that comes to my mind was probably 4th of July weekend with all of my friends. So we started this tradition years ago. I think this was it pre-COVID? I want to say it was pre-COVID. We get a group together. There's usually like 10 to 12 of us, and we rent a house in Door County for the 4th. We usually go for, I don't know, like four days, three nights, and we go on the boat, we cook at home, we like have bonfires, we go to the bars. We didn't do it last year because just no one was able to make it. So was so happy that we did it again this year. We had so much fun. We had a house that was right by like Husby's. It was right in Sister Bay. I mean, literally like from our front porch, you could see Husby's. So that was a lot of fun. And we, you know, like every morning we got up and cooked breakfast and had coffee and played cards and just all kind of talked and walked around town. We went on the boat during the day. At night, we went to the bars. It was just a lot of fun getting to kind of, I guess, like unplug and just kind of go hang out with your friends for a couple days. So that was definitely a peak. Another peak was the weekend that I got to spend with all my high school friends. We try to get together once a year because a lot of people have moved and don't live here anymore. So we try to meet up somewhere at some point, someone's cabin, someone's house, whatever, once a summer. We went to Milwaukee. One of my best friends lives in Muskego. So we all went to her house for the weekend, and then I got us all tickets to see Keith Urban at Summerfest, which was so fun because we all grew up together, and you know, Keith Urban's music is like what we grew up on. So it was just really cool to get to spend the weekend with them and get to see them. Another peak is my like oldest, bestest friend, Katie. Shout out Katie if she's listening. She moved home. And I'm so happy. She's lived in the South for like years and years. She has 3 kids who I never got to see. And now her and her husband just moved home. So I'm very happy for that. One of my other best friends had a baby. Shout out Anne. She had her little girl. My other best friend, Chelsea, is expecting. It's just been, you know, a fun summer. A lot of big milestones. Not for me, clearly. But yeah, a lot of peaks. So I guess I can't pick just one, and I'm probably forgetting something, but you know, whatever. So those are my pits, my peaks. I know everyone comes to this podcast wondering what is going on with my dating life, and I mean, not a lot. I think I talked about it a lot on the episodes earlier in the year that I was kind of taking a sabbatical and just kind of focusing on myself. And I definitely have still been doing that. I haven't been saying no. Like, I've gone on a handful, I probably count on one hand, dates this year, this summer, and just wasn't it. Like, there was one, you guys, that within 2 minutes, I was just like, I do not want to be here anymore. Why am I doing this? I hate this feeling, but you have to get yourself out there. And like, nothing against the guy who's nice, but just wasn't it for me. And so I've definitely still been focusing on myself, and I do have some good stories for you guys, but it feels awkward telling said stories when I'm just in a room by myself. I feel like that would have to be an episode that I do with one of my friends where I kind of dive into fun stories. I've definitely had men from the past circle back around, which has been always interesting when that happens. So, you know, that's a thing. But just know that I'm still focusing on myself. I have reintroduced myself to the dating apps, but I barely go on them because they're just truly depressing. Like, I go on there and what is that song that's viral on TikTok where people, oh, it's the Taylor Swift song, like, I hate it here, so often. Yeah, that's me every time I go on a dating app. So have not gone on any dates from the dating apps. I haven't even met anyone, probably because I'm not trying. Anyone I've gone out with or, you know, whatever has been people I meet in real life or people coming back around. So that's that for my dating life. Unfortunately, have not found love quite yet, but I'm not giving up. And that's pretty much that. I will have episodes coming up with some of my friends. So we'll, you know, dive into more fun stories that I know that you enjoy hearing and living vicariously through me. Trust me, I have quite a few for you. So we will get into that in later episodes. Today, though, is all about Meghan Patrick. I just kind of wanted to give you guys, you know, a quick intro, letting you know what's new with me. Not a whole lot. Pretty much the same girl I was however many months ago, just with more crazy stories. So without further ado, I am going to play you my conversation with Meghan Patrick. I need you to just listen to the whole thing. I'm obsessed with her. So enjoy.
Oh God.
All right, so my podcast name is Caffeinated and Confused, so I just need to know if you are both of those things.
Yes, most days.
Perfect.
Well, same. Actually, I'm definitely caffeinated every day, and most days also confused.
I love that. Okay, yeah. We're going to get along just fine. How many cups of coffee do you think you like have a day, or what is the most you've ever had?
Oh, gosh. I mean, so I'm pretty, like, sensitive to caffeine, actually, so I try my best to keep it to like 1 Celsius or something in the morning. Or if I drink coffee, I might have like 1 in the morning. And then if I need a little pick me up, it just depends on what I'm doing. Like if I'm on the road and I have to be up super early and then I also have to play a show that night, I'm probably going to need to caffeinate a couple times that day.
Absolutely. Did you see the, I think it was Dakota Johnson did an interview where she was talking about how she would drink like 4 Celsius a day because she like thought it was a health drink.
She's That's
like,
truly insane.
Yeah. And she how was she like, alive? Yeah. So I laid in bed at night and I couldn't sleep. And she was like, I was just thinking to myself, wow, like I am just so alive and just like so full of creative like juices. And then she's like, then I realized that a Celsius is 3 cups of coffee.
Yeah, it's like 200 milligrams of caffeine.
It's insane. People think I'm psycho. I'll like go to the gym and have a Celsius in the morning and then I'll have a coffee a couple hours later. They're like, are you okay? I'm like, no, I'm not.
That's, yeah, I mean, everybody's different. Like I said, I'm pretty like set. Like I generally, that's why I try to only have it in the morning, because if I do have it in the afternoon, like I'm gonna have a hard time sleeping. The only time where I can get away with that is if I have a show, because I burn so much energy. My live show is so much, you know, I have so much like energy on the stage that sometimes I can sleep after. But even then, it's like, it's hard for me to get into a schedule of going to bed early, even if I want to or I have the opportunity to, because like anytime I play a show, it takes me hours to like wind down after I play, just from the adrenaline of it all. And so, yeah, sleeping is a tough one for me.
I know. I was going to ask that, because I feel like I've heard interviews or seen podcasts where artists talk about like how crazy it is to go from being on stage and you have thousands of people screaming and you're just up there like living your dream, and then you just go on a bus or whatever or a hotel room and you just kind of sit there like, okay,
yeah,
like now what? Now I have to just sleep?
Yeah, it's definitely, it's hard, because it's also, it's a lot to, I'm just like a very observant, hyper aware person of my surroundings and the people around me. And so it's like, I'm still processing the show. I'm still thinking about the audience. I'm thinking about every aspect of, okay, what songs, what parts of the set felt like they really hit tonight and really resonated. Did I like the order of the set? Did it feel like it had a good flow? Like, I am definitely hyper analyzing everything that happened.
For
that
sure.
Night. So yeah. Sometimes it's hard to like shut my brain off.
Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, I do that like even when we have shows or whatever, and then it's like going home and just kind of having to unwind.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I want to get to the beginning. By the way, we have Meghan Patrick on the podcast.
I'm Meghan Patrick.
Welcome.
Thank you.
I am always just so intrigued about artists' stories of how they started, or how you like realized that you know, could write songs and sing, mm-hmm. and how you kind of started. So can you just kind of take me back to the beginning?
Totally. Let me try and give you the short story. Okay, so I mean, I grew up in a home that was definitely very like musical. We listened to a lot of music growing up, whether we were in the car or even at the house. Like, we didn't really watch a lot of TV. My dad played guitar just as a hobby. He never did it professionally, but you know, it was around. I first learned that I could sing because I auditioned for my school musical. I think it was in like 6th grade maybe. And that was kind of when I figured out like, oh, I can sing and I like singing. And my teacher at the time, she had approached me. She knew of some vocal teachers, and she was just like, if that's something you're interested in doing, taking some lessons, I can, you know, talk to your parents. So I started taking vocal lessons. My teacher, you know, it was more of a classical kind of program. My teacher was pretty convinced that I needed to be an opera singer.
Stop it.
I had a really powerful voice. I had a lot of range. And so that was what I studied. I did, it's called the Royal Conservatory. So it's like different grades and levels that you can study outside of like your regular school. And, I mean, long story short, I did that all through high school, but I also, you know, really my big focus and my big dream for a long time was actually to go to the Olympics as a competitive snowboarder.
Wow.
And so that was my main focus and took most of my time all through, you know, grade school into high school. And when I was in my senior year of high school, I was warming up in a competition. I had a really bad fall. Broke my back, dislocated my shoulder, snapped my collarbone, broken ribs, severe concussion. I was unconscious for almost a minute. And
wow.
I should have been paralyzed. Like,
yeah.
I should not have walked away from that accident. That's not to say that it wasn't a really awful recovery. And I mean, I still suffer from, you know, migraines and stuff from the concussions, and my back is kind of messed up. But I did walk away, thankfully. And you know, during that recovery is where I really turned to music, because it had always been there. I always loved it, but it hadn't been my main focus. But suddenly I'm laid up. I can't even walk on my own. And so, you know, I listened to a lot of music. I would write lyrics and, you know, I'd play my guitar because there just wasn't a lot I could do at that time. And so when I came out on the other side of that recovery, my whole trajectory had changed. My focus had shifted. And I had made a deal with my parents because they really wanted me. They had a high value on going to college and they really wanted me to do that. I wanted to keep training and going to the Olympics. And so they had made the deal that if I made the national development team in my senior year, they were cool with me deferring school to keep chasing that. And obviously that accident destroyed those dreams.
Yeah.
So I was just like, well, I guess I'll study music. Like, what else am I didn't really know what else I wanted to do. And so I went to McGill University to study opera. It's a great music program, one of the best in the country. And after about a year of that, I was like, okay, this is absolutely not for me. Yeah. I was passionate about singing and, you know, I enjoyed the challenge of training in that way and learning what my voice could do. I got a lot of great kind of groundwork laid for technique in terms of breathing and how to use my voice and everything. So I'm very grateful for that. But I just wasn't passionate about opera as a genre. And so I had met some guys that were in the jazz program there, and we ended up starting a band together. And we were called the New Groove Orchestra. It was a 10-piece funk band, like Tower of Power.
Your life trajectory at this point
I've
is
lived
just
a lot
like,
of lies.
Oh my God. I'm just imagining like an opera singer going down a ski hill, just like singing on her snowboard. Like some wild TikToks could have been
made. I'm pretty
weird.
For sure.
I'm obsessed.
Yeah. And so that was kind of another like light bulb moment for me because, you know, I mean, I had a band my first band was when I was 13, when I was in high school and going into high school with my friend Hill. And this was the first time we were really doing, I mean, we were touring, we recorded an album and everything. And that was when I was like, okay, I really love this. And so I ended up switching into the jazz program for a bit, kind of searching for something that made sense to me. I liked it better, but I still, at that point, I just was so much more shifting my focus into just wanting to write songs and perform. And I ended up going back home for a summer and meeting a guy from my hometown. We started playing together and writing songs together, and we ended up starting a bluegrass band. And that
just
was
getting better.
Yeah. And so that I always joke and say bluegrass was my gateway drug to country music.
Yeah.
You know, and we did a whole summer tour. We toured the whole East Coast in Canada. And that was the moment when I was just like, this is it. There's absolutely no question in my mind. This is what I want to do for a living. I want to be on the road. I want to get a publishing deal, a record deal. And so I told my parents I was dropping out to pursue that. And, you know, and rightfully so. I don't think it was their favorite phone call, you
I'm
know.
Sure, yeah.
But, you know, my dad was pretty great about it. He just said, well, look, if that's what you want to do, then I'm in your corner. He's like, just don't do it half-ass. You know, if you're going to do it, go all in. And also, I'm not giving you any more money.
You got to do it on your
yes.
own.
Yes. And truly, that was a blessing. That was a gift for him to do that for me, because the reality about this industry and being an artist, you are going to figure out real quick how bad you really want it, especially when you don't have a safety net, when you don't have someone paying your way, when you are truly like in the grind yourself. And I was, I mean, of course, like if my dad wasn't going to let me starve on the street, you
yeah.
know, but I was also very proud and very stubborn. And I literally, I mean, I would go busk on street corners before I'd ask my dad for grocery money. And so, you know, that was kind of the beginning of that journey. And it was a lot of struggle, and I was really broke for a few years, but I was chasing the dream. And finally I had a little bit of a break. I got a manager and got my first record deal, my first publishing deal. And, I stayed in Canada for, I think it was about 2 years after I signed my deal to kind of build a fan base and do some touring there. And I got to a point where, you know, if I wasn't on the road, I was in Nashville writing, and I wasn't spending a lot of time back home. And when I did go back home, it felt like every time I went back home, it was less and less of a fit for me. It suddenly felt like I was trying to be two different people. This person who was, you know, going to Nashville and writing songs and then going out on the road and touring and then coming back home, where I just didn't have a lot in common with a lot of the people I grew up with. I mean, I love them, still love them to this day, but it just, I didn't feel focused when I was home. I didn't feel inspired to create or write when I was there, because it was just such a different situation there. And so I made the decision to move to Nashville. So that was almost 8 years ago.
Wow. Isn't it crazy too? I sometimes feel like when you have to bust your ass and just like work really hard mm-hmm. and not like rock bottom, but you just appreciate mm-hmm. like the high moments so much more than.
Trust me, I've been rock bottom. And yes. Yeah. But rock bottom is necessary to
Absolutely.
Success. Because, you know, you can be influenced so easily. You can get so in your head in this industry and you can get caught up worrying about what other people are doing. You get caught up taking advice from people that really don't know what they're doing any more than you do. And you can really lose yourself in it. When you want something so bad, you can lose yourself in it. And I did at a certain point. And, you know, when things kind of really were tough for me, like COVID happened, I had a really contentious separation of a relationship with part of my team, with someone that did a lot of damage to my career. And I, you know, I lost my first record deal. I got dropped after COVID. I couldn't go play in Canada for like 2 years, which was at the time I had signed with Riser House and we were getting started in the US, but I was nobody. I was a brand new artist here. So I wasn't making any money yet. If I did go play shows, all of the money I had been making was in Canada and I couldn't go there for 2 years. So it was just devastating. It just felt like everything I loved was being taken away from me. I had built this really successful career in Canada and felt like I just came tumbling all the way down from the top of the mountain. And I got really desperate to just get back up there. And I just started listening to a lot of other opinions and I kind of lost myself and lost the joy of what I was creating. And after all of that happened, that was kind of like my rock bottom for my career. I went through a lot on a personal level too. I started going to therapy and just doing a lot of inner work and healing. And when I kind of came on the other side of that, I made myself a promise that, like, look, if I'm going to get back up and take another swing, I'm going to do it on my terms. And I'm going to really follow my gut, follow my heart. Because, look, I'm 37 years old. I've been studying music for more than half of my life. I've been touring and playing in bands since I was 13 years old. Like, I know what the hell I'm doing. Mm-hmm. I know just as much, if not more, as anyone else in this industry. And if I'm ever going to go all in on myself, now is the time. And so that's what this record is for me. It is a kind of a very cathartic and empowering moment for me because it's the first time in my life where I had a vision for the music. I had a vision for everything to do with the record, from the cover of it, the visual aesthetic of it, everything. And I promised myself that I would not compromise this time, even when people didn't get it, even when other people were pushing back, even when I felt totally alone in what I was chasing. I promised myself that I would not back down and I would not compromise. And I've stayed true to that. And it's a good feeling.
And I feel like that's just a good message for females everywhere, because I know I'm the same way. Just being a woman in mm-hmm. I guess any industry, but specifically this industry, it's a lot of men. And you spend so many years, you know, in your younger years working in the industry where mm-hmm. you just kind of are a doormat and you're like, I'm going to do whatever these people tell me to do because I'm going to trust them. But then mm-hmm. it comes with age and you hit a certain point where you're like, screw that. Like, I know who I am. Yeah. I know what I can do for the world. And it's like the moment that you kind of have that shift. And like mm-hmm. you said, you were going to therapy and I'm sure you were internalizing a lot of stuff and mm-hmm. learning a lot of things. And it's like once you hit that point and you're like, no, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do it my way. And it's crazy how like yep. then that's kind of when things start to.
That's when it happens.
Exactly.
Yeah. But you know what? Also, it's like it's and as it pertains to being a woman in the industry, too, there's a whole other aspect that we have to deal with in that, like, our behavior is held to a different standard.
So than men's. Stupid. It makes me so.
You
mad.
Know, I am married to a male artist, you know, so I've been in the room with him when he's been on the phone, when he's been frustrated or when he's trying to get his point across or he's trying to, you know, talk to his team or talk to somebody. And if I were to use the same tone, the same passion, the same words, it would be received very differently. Mm-hmm. And he knows that because he's lived with me. So he's watched it happen. And it's been eye opening for Mitchell as well to see, oh, wow. OK, so it is different for you. But at the same time, as much as that exists, like that doesn't mean that we as women have to worry about it. Like,
preach.
If you think that I'm a bitch or I'm a mm-hmm. diva because I advocate for myself, because I'm passionate about what I do, because I'm not going to settle for less than what I want something to be. Like, yeah, I am a pain in the ass sometimes. I've gone back and forth you know, with when we're making this docuseries, when we're making album covers, videos, all of that. And I have an amazing director, Ford. And that was the thing that I learned, is that people who truly love you and respect you are not going to be annoyed at you demanding the best from them. They are not going to be butthurt about you trying to make something great.
Well, and it's your name on the project. Right. Like, this is your passion. And, like, these are your words that mm-hmm. you're putting out into the world. Like,
right.
The fact that there are people out there who think they know you more than you know you, you know, it's just crazy. And I get that it's part of the shtick and
it's ego.
Yeah. But it's just, it's a really cool message, I feel like, to send to women in any industry, where it's like, you need to like stick up for yourself and you're mm-hmm. not a bitch. You're not, you know, being a pain or you're not. No, it's like, I have the struggles all the time.
Because when men do
that,
they're what a savvy businessman. They're powerful. They're respected. And here's the thing, there are tons of, as much as there are men who are threatened by that in the industry, there's a lot of great men in this industry mm-hmm. too, who love a woman who advocates for herself, who love a powerful, strong woman. And so you just need to find those people. If you advocating for yourself or demanding the best from your team becomes a problem with someone, they shouldn't be on your team. You go find the people that are on the same page as you and that understand that you have a certain goal and you have a way that you want to get there. They have to be on the same page. And anybody who doesn't get it, well, then that's their problem. Like, truly, what other people think of me is none of my business. It's not my problem.
It's such a hard thing to learn.
If you want to approach me because you have an issue with something I'm doing and you want to talk about it, absolutely. I respect the hell out of that. Be straight with me and we'll talk it out. But if you have an issue with me and you don't bother to speak to me about it, you don't bother to approach me about it, well, that's your problem. I'm not going to stress about it, you know?
I love that. Okay, so I want to talk about the album because it comes out on Friday. Are you just like freaking out? Are you peeing your pants? Are you excited? Are you scared? Like, what are all the feelings you're feeling right now?
I feel very at peace.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah, and that is a new feeling for me, days away from a big release. I mean, this is without question the biggest release I've ever had. This is the best album I've ever made. I mean, this is like my life's work, yeah. You know? And I've been saying it feels like I've been writing this record my whole life. And I mean, in a technical sense, that's not true. But in the greater sense of things, I have, because it is really the culmination of my whole story. It is digging into my deepest, darkest hurts, my biggest losses, my biggest wins, the heartbreak, and then falling in love, finding my best friend and my soulmate and the journey of all of that. And what's really at the core of it all is it's a story of healing and self-love and empowerment. You know, I told you, obviously, I went through a lot career-wise, but I also went through a lot personally in the last few years. And so the title of the album, Golden Child, actually came before the song, Golden Child.
I always wonder that. Like, do you come up with, because I know a lot of people will name their album after a specific song.
Usually that's how it's, that's how I've always done it. That's usually been the case. But in this case, the title Golden Child actually came from lyrics from another song that's on the record. It's the first song on the record. It's called Blood from a Stone. And the first line in that song is, I was a golden child. So I had decided to name the record that, and we ended up writing the song Golden Child after the fact. But I wanted to start the record with Blood from a Stone because in a lot of ways, writing that song was where it all started for me, where the vision for this record came from, and where the courage and inspiration for this record came from. You know, that song speaks to my childhood and the way I was raised. Unfortunately, I don't have a relationship with my mother. And it was a very contentious one growing up. I was raised as the golden child, you know, and a golden child. I was the star athlete, the honor roll student, then the country singer, you know, all of these things that served a narrative that suited her, you know, and mm-hmm. but and the good thing, and there's positives about it. It made me very hardworking, made me very ambitious, made me very tough and very resilient. But the dark side of that is growing up believing and being told that your value is entirely tied to your success. And if you are not successful, you are not valuable. You are not worthy of love. You are not worthy. And the love is very conditional on you being that golden child. And so that just, I mean, that is me. That's who I am. And that has shaped and defined me as a human being in such a profound way. It was the perfect title for the album. And when I wrote that song, it was after I had set some boundaries with her that were what I needed at the time. And it was the right choice for me. It was necessary. And when I went in and wrote that song, it was, you know, I had essentially reached out to her and given her kind of one last chance to just and said, this is all the ways that you've hurt me and manipulated me and abused me. And I am, you know, I'm getting ready to get married. I am going to therapy. I am working on being my best self. And I just can no longer have any kind of toxic relationships in my life if I'm going to continue to heal. So, you know, you've never taken any accountability. You've never changed. And so until you can take some accountability and show me that you are genuinely trying to change, I can't have you in my life. And she never responded. So no answer was an answer. Mm-hmm. And when I went in to write that day with Karen Kozowski, who is also the producer on the record, and my friend Emily, it had been 3 days. And so it was kind of me coming to the realization of, okay, she's not going to respond. This is, I got an answer.
Yeah.
And it was hurtful, of course, but I kind of already knew deep down that that's how it was going to go. And the silver lining of it is that it was very cathartic and it was freeing. It gave me permission to set the boundaries I needed to set. It gave me permission to move on and continue to focus on myself and being my best self and not feel guilty about the boundaries I was setting. And it was the first time I ever even spoke some of those words aloud, let alone put them into a song. And when I wrote the song and I turned it in, I mean, the response was crazy just with the team and anyone I showed it to. Everyone was like, oh my gosh, like, are you going to put this out? This is maybe one of the best songs you've ever written. And so, you know, I had a lot of talks with my family and my manager and my husband about, like, I think I'm going to put this song out. And I had to really also work out in my head why I wanted to put it out and what the purpose of it was. Because I want to be really clear. The purpose of it is not to hurt her. It is not out of spite. It's not even really from a place of anger or hatred or anything like that. It is just simply me sharing my experience. Because if I was going to tell my whole story on this record, which was the plan, which was the goal, I couldn't leave such a massive part out because it shaped me so much. And I also wanted to put it out because I think, you know, something that's really important to me, of course, I want commercial success, but I also want to feel fulfilled in my success. And fulfillment for me comes from knowing I'm having an impact on my fans and my listeners and knowing that I can take my platform and my voice and the God-given gifts I have to write songs to help other people, you know, through their own pain, through their own trauma. And I my hope with this song is that it will be relatable and healing to others that have been through what I've been through. And I hope it'll be empowering for them and give them the permission they need to do what's best for themselves. Because there's a lot of stigma around, you know, adult children who set those kind of boundaries with their family, their parents, because people who haven't been through that don't understand. And I get that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the, but what do you mean? That's your mom or that's your dad. And it's like, okay, well, cool. So what? They get a free pass on abusing me? Like, that's
like
not...
I'm trying to protect my peace. Like, I'm a human too.
And at the end of the day, all I could think about was my future children. God willing, Mitchell and I are going to have babies one day, and I will be damned if they are going to suffer the way that I did. And I knew that in order for me to one day be the mother that I wanted to be, I had to let go of her and that situation, because it was not serving me. It was destroying me.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a really painful, difficult, it's the hardest decision I ever made in my life. But there's no question in my mind 2 years later, when I still haven't spoken to her, still haven't heard from her, that it was the right choice. So my hope is that when other people hear that song, it will give them permission to speak about what they're going through. It will give them permission to know that they're to not feel that guilt that us children feel and to do what's best for them.
For sure. And just like you, you know, telling your story and hearing your story, it's crazy to just see kind of how the universe works, because you obviously have this gift of your voice and, you know, singing songs. And if the accident wouldn't have happened with, mm-hmm. you know, the snowboarding incident, you might not ever be here yep. writing these words. You may not have ever gotten to this, you know, point in your life where you were able to set boundaries mm-hmm. and then in turn inspire and share your story. So it's yep. just kind of crazy. Like when you hit a certain age and you just kind of look back, you're like, damn, like mm-hmm. that heartbreak or that, you know, moment where I was told mm-hmm. no or whatever, it all yes. leads you to the yeah. moment that you're in. And, you know, yeah. that it, family issues are like so touchy and almost taboo because mm-hmm. you almost feel bad
yeah.
talking about it.
You
and
do
you're
feel
like,
bad.
Exactly.
There's a lot of guilt around yeah. that for sure. And people that don't understand, they put that guilt on you because they don't understand. And so, you know, but that's okay. It, like, again, it just comes back to like, if you can't be bothered to understand what I'm going through, if you can't be bothered to put yourself in my shoes
mm-hmm.
and you don't agree with what I'm doing, you don't agree with the decision that I've made, that's fine. You're not part of my life. You have nothing to do with me. The people that matter to me, they understand and they have my back and they support me. And I love what you said, because, you know, when I look back on my life, as much as I have suffered, I've been through some really traumatic things, but all of the most hurtful and traumatic things that have happened to me with the help of, you know, my friends and my family and God, I've been able to turn them into something beautiful, you know, and
you were
and
given
it's turned,
a gift for a reason.
Absolutely. And, you know, like I said, the injury, it was terrible, but it was sort of a gift in and of itself, because that was God's not so subtle way of saying, hey, I've actually got something else over here for you that's better, you know. And I, you know, I suffered, I survived a violent relationship, a physical and emotionally abusive relationship. And the silver lining and beauty of that is, you know, fast forward years later, last year we put on our first charity fundraiser for survivors of domestic violence. We're doing it again this year, and we're going to make it an annual thing. And eventually, when I can build it up enough, I'm going to have my own foundation. And again, I wouldn't have been able to help other women if I hadn't had that experience myself mm-hmm. to make me so passionate about helping other women. So, you know, that's life. It's
absolutely.
It's ups and downs, and you take the bad and you try and turn it into something beautiful.
For sure. Well, I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
And I'm very excited for the album, and I'm excited to get to hear the story and for you to be able to inspire other women and other men and whoever listens to it to kind of just, you know, be able to make those decisions that are hard, that are embarrassing, or that you feel like you shouldn't make, but you know deep down that you should.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I'm obsessed with country music mm-hmm. and just the
Me
stories
too.
It tells and, you know, the inspiration behind it. So I'm so excited for you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. Thanks for coming on. And let's go get some more coffee. We'll
yes.
get more caffeinated.
I definitely am ready.
All right. Perfect.